Okay, call to order. Healthy Library and Board of Trustees meeting from the community of the main library, August 28, 2017. It is 5:05 PM. One thing to notice, the time limit on each part of the agenda, the director and I spoke about this and we both agreed upon it. So that it will be strictly adhered to. So roll call, I'm here, Al Beaver.
Here.
Trustee McMullin.
Here.
McDonald, Trustee Dumbaugh. Fantastic. For the adoption of the agenda, we have the opportunity now for board members to delete items, to reorder items, continue items, and make additions to the agenda pursuant to Government Code Section 5495. Are there any changes in the conditions? No. Government hereby adopts.
I move that we adopt. Second.
Okay, the Board of Library Trustees hereby adopts the agenda as presented. Public communications? Oh, vote, sorry, vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Noes? Very good. Public communication, citizens may address the board regarding any item of library business on or not on the agenda. Citizen comments are limited to 3 minutes per item. At the discretion of the president, citizens may be allowed a longer presentation. All comments are welcome. The Brown Act does not allow the board to take action on any item not on the agenda. Speaking before the board, please give your name and address and state the agenda item and or issue which you wish to address. And we have one person who would like to speak. That's Ms. Jenna.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Ready to repeat my name and address?
Goodbye.
Gail Meltzer, 2351 Grander Avenue, Pasadena. Like most, if not all of you, I've been a library lover from the time I was very little. I've been involved with libraries in Jersey City, where I grew up, in New Brunswick, New Jersey, where I went to college at Rutgers, and then in various other places where I've lived, from Alabama to Florida to Texas and finally in Altadena. I've never seen such an exciting and inspiring library transformation as I've seen here. I moved here from Miami in 2015. Over the past 2 years, I've watched in awe as Mindy solidified her vision for the growth of the library, and then step by step made it happen. She transformed this library from a repository of books to an exciting, dynamic community hub. I've seen her put initiatives into place to engage the largest number of residents possible, from offering exciting programs for all ages, almost every day of the week, to undertaking the Extraordinary Community Conversations Project. Dozens of these conversations took place all over the town, and the follow-up meeting was terrific. This process helped build relationships, allow people to voice their hopes and dreams for Altadena, while educating the community about all the new things going on at the library. I also had the opportunity to attend a recent board training on fundraising for libraries, which as a fundraising consultant nonprofit, I found very important. My impression is that many see Altadena as a fragmented community with no center. In her 3-year tenure, Mindy has done a truly amazing job of connecting all segments of the community with information and resources. There's a new community events calendar and a beautiful newsletter, both print and digital. The library has a vibrant social media presence. These kinds of things are invaluable in a town with no newspaper. In the midst of all these enhancements, Mindy has also upgraded the physical space, dramatically improving the aesthetics of the library. I am proud to take this opportunity to publicly congratulate Mindy, her staff, and all the volunteers, including you trustees. Your collective passion for what libraries can and should be has enabled our library to beautifully come into its own. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark, Marisol, for comment.
Thank you. I didn't know you definitely had to fill it out, so that's why I didn't fill it out ahead of time. But I do want to thank you for, I know I said something last time, and it looks like you have a little bit more on your consent calendar, which helps you get through your business a little faster. And I know one of the goals is that to not have longer meetings. So I do want to make another suggestion just for you. When you write the time down for time certain, it should really be time certain that you want to have a specific item because you have somebody coming to the meeting. So, you know, if it's a friend and you put 6:10 down, then I know I'll be speaking at 6:10 or somebody from the friends will be speaking at 6:10. But if you do something like 5:05 to 5:15 financial reports, I mean, you pretty much have killed public comment, which you need to keep up if we're going to try to go through that. So my suggestion is that you just look at for the next time, for the next agenda, that you would just, the things you want to specifically have at a certain time, you either have speakers or you want to make sure you cut off to go on to some other topics. That would probably be a better way instead of trying to have everything time certain for every agenda item, because it'll just, you know, kind of mess you guys up, and I don't think you really want to do that. You really want to get through and have concise meetings. And probably the best way, as I said, is your consent calendar, where you know you would read all your stuff ahead of time. You really have a question, then you ask. But if not, you're just approving those kind of general things that go through the board. So I just wanted to thank you for that and share that.
Thanks, Mark. Now, we have one more public comment.
Unie LaFontaine, 2003 Glen Avenue. I'm the volunteer coordinator here at the library. A lot of you guys know me. I just wanted to say that I know we had the board retreat not too long ago, and it was a full day. It's a long day to come and talk about those kind of things, but it was very helpful, and I want to point out a couple of things. We're trying to build our foundation right now, so as much as no one wants to talk about raising money, it's always really hard. You want to talk about the fun things, but the raising money part is a big part of having a foundation and building a foundation, and a lot of the information that we learned at that retreat is now being applied to us adding new people to the foundation, and that's something that we are full force trying to do right now. So I just wanted to put it out there that a lot of people came in, they have contacted me because of their interest in the foundation and volunteering, and some of those people even helped with our recent Eclipse program, which was huge. So raising money is not always fun to talk about, but it is an important part of building our foundation, and our foundation is an important part of what happens here at the library. So, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we're done with public comments. Personnel appointments, resignations, transfers, types, announcements, no appointments, and three resignations. I can read them. Carla Vogel, looks like he's part-time.
You usually don't go through them. If you have any specific questions, you can ask. Otherwise, you just.
You want to have any specific questions? I know your auditors very well, so
I work well with them, and I know what they're expecting when they come out as well. I do also come in and do the bank reconciliations every month, and that serves as an external control over Nicole, who's doing everything. She's doing a great job, but when you have, we want a separation of duties a little bit, and she's doing everything, you have to have somebody from the outside come in and do the bank rec. It's just good practice. And so I come in and do that. That doesn't take long every month. You know, we're going, since I just started, it's taking a little bit longer, just as I get to know you as a district. Once I get to know you a little bit more, at that point, then I'll bring in my staff after I feel comfortable that I've assessed what you need, and then they'll work, and they reduce, they work obviously at a reduced rate than what I work at. So I try and transition to them as soon as I can, but as soon as I do transition to them, then I oversee the work. So it's never where there isn't a CPA looking at what's done every month, to the point that we're comfortable with it. So that's really all I had to say. I'm happy to answer any questions you have about me, my background, or what I'm doing.
What's the name of your firm?
Platinum Consulting Group.
And since you're in the middle, not in the middle, but in the process of doing something, and we're going to have a possible action, you know, to approve the financial reports. So is it something that's still in process that we're not at the point where we need to approve it yet? And where are you at?
Yes, very much addressed.
Then we don't need to approve something.
I would think not.
Thank you.
I don't think those change materially, but mm-hmm. things that have not posted are your pension entries, and some those are some of the larger entries.
So that's going to affect the
overall. It will, but I guess I would caution to say what you're looking at is probably very close to what you're going to see at the end. Those expense amounts that will change because of the pension rules that really don't touch your cash. So this is a good picture of kind of your cash results before we start to do all our accounting focus, which some people think of it as, where we're doing pension entries that are based on 2 years ago that kind of mess up your expense and don't really have anything to do with the cash you paid out during the year. But if you were to approve it, it's draft format. It's going to change.
I'd rather approve this final.
Okay.
During the closure and afterwards, there was such a tremendous amount of work, and that we were slower on being able to order all the items that we wanted to order. Do you want to add anything to that?
Yep. Also, I started what, third month into the fiscal year. We also had a retirement for, so a short staff for what, about a month and a half. So all those components played into it, but definitely trying to do the remodel definitely hit us hard. So this year will be better. Right now we're also kind of minimal expenditure for the summer because of migration to our new ILS. We've been trying to address some of the purchase suggestions we're getting in terms of trying to get materials to the patrons who are requesting them. Looks like we're good to go live with our ordering within the next few days here, so we'll be able to start picking up a regular monthly expenditure.
So then is there a plan to have that amount set aside and put back into the budget for this fiscal year?
I did not raise the amount this fiscal year. I think it's about the same for materials. If we find that there are holes or there's a need to purchase more items, we can look at that as a mid-year budget adjustment.
No more questions. I was just looking up the list.
Okay.
approve the budget was for this coming year.
We can move on to the consent calendar?
It was actually cut this coming year. So I think that's concerning, I probably should consider designating those funds for library materials. Let's move on to the next bring, another meeting.
The consent calendar, recommended board action will be enacted when growth support segment will pass staff report, is anyone wish to remove an item? On the consent calendar for discussion and consideration, the matters removed from consent calendar will be considered individually, and the consent agenda under items removed from the consent calendar. Item remaining consent calendar is then voted upon by roll call under one motion. So recommended action for library trustees, if I approve the items, recommended action for consent calendar will be adopted. In the regular meeting held July 24th, 2017. Approval of the minutes from the special meeting of July 29th, 2017. Fiscal reports, your date, July 2017, departmental monthly report, July 2017. Job descriptions, library clerk one general, library clerk one collection department, library clerk two general. Resetting of the main library parking lot pool for the director of science coordinator payment. Jonathan, is...
No, it's consent calendar, there's no presentation.
Right.
All the documents are in here.
Right, so if I have questions about the quote...
You have to move it out of consent agenda.
But he's not here, and I want to ask him.
Well, I can probably ask him, I'm familiar with the process.
Got it. Which one do you choose?
Excuse me?
Which one are you going to choose, there are three?
Oh, I believe it says in the report, let me...
You wrote a cover letter for the quote.
No.
I don't certainly think you...
Yeah, I don't feel pretty fast.
Yeah, I think it's right out.
Yeah, permacast page...
Page 49.
Page 49.
Let's remove it from the calendar and then ask questions.
Okay, but...
I might have some questions.
Me? So we'll move it. All right, we'll move it from the calendar. So then we have consideration of items from the report, first we have a vote.
And I also have one on the departmental report, just a question about the IT report. Can we remove that one?
Right, and so the entire remaining consent calendar can vote upon.
So we're removing item F and which one? Item D? I move that we approve the consent calendar without, Chris went to remove item D and F from the consent calendar.
Can I ask you about the parking lot issue before we do the vote?
Yes.
My question, if the parking lot can be closed, but how are we going to address that?
We often close our parking lot, and we still keep the library open.
For 3 days?
Well, we have had the parking lot closed, maybe not for 3 days. So, I mean, we'll notify the public, and we'll have signage and everything. It's actually only supposed to take 1 day, but that makes me nervous, so I put 3 days in there, just to be on the same side.
That's my question.
So you're going to remove it from the consent calendar, so there'll be discussion later on.
Yes.
Can I remove anything else, so we can vote for them?
Yes, do we want to remove anything else?
I have a question, I may have to move it.
EMS.
Yeah. So maybe someone can second and vote to.
Second.
John second. And all in favor?
Aye.
Those? No? Now, in consideration of items moved to the consent calendar.
To the consent calendar, so they can vote to items.
Now we discuss those two items. And Z, Ms. Barbara Luton?
Yes, I don't think Chris is first here. But I had a question on the IT report under the section about the historical society using the past perfect software licensing. Is this initiative something that the library is doing to develop a historical archive catalog, and are we piggybacking on their subscription for that software? Sorry, it's page.
Page 39.
Page 39, the second to last paragraph.
We are going to get our own subscription. The reason we're doing this is because the library has about 30 scrapbooks, all full of newspaper articles and other information that were created over many years of this library. And we also have drawers full of other historical documents and and photos. Yes, tons of photos. And they're all falling apart and disintegrating, and we wanted to be able to scan those and store those in a way, in a permanent way. And but we also thought we would talk to the Historical Society to let them know what we're doing on our side, so that if there's any possibility for partnering and sharing that information and helping them out, we could do that as well. So that's what we're doing with that software. Is storing all the library's historical documents, not the historical documents of all the DNF.
So I'd like to say this is a great initiative, probably well past due, but the write-up makes it sound like we are using their software. So the last sentence, the partnership would be a good example of efficient use of taxpayer dollars by avoiding travelers with duplicate software licensing. I don't think that's that's all.
Madam F, Armando, your questions?
I do have one. Armando, you can start.
Mr. Johnson, just for
oh, okay.
How you doing?
Hi.
Do I
go ahead.
My question about the parking, what are our plans for dealing with possibly three days of the parking lot being closed? So what are the patrons going to be using?
Well, we've had before in the past, but we haven't been parking on the street and things like that. My paving vendor has told me that basically, you know, 1 to 3 days. He said he could probably finish it in 2, but why we said 3 is because to make sure that the parking lot is more stable. Not saying it will not be, but making sure that the parking lot will be, you know, fine and all pages coming. Yeah, be set. Yes, it'll be set. And so just the parking will be on the side of the street. We'll have them for when we did the 50th anniversary, we have parking on the side of the street, and that has been sufficient for that.
Yeah, our streets don't tend to have a lot of cars on
them. No, normally no. Yeah. And there is parking on the north side, on Mariposa side. Mm-hmm. Also, there's parking on Diodorus Street where they can go mm-hmm. and park on the side.
Are they able to work on a day we're closed?
If we need to, but still you would have 1 day for planing. It'll be cold planing the lot, and once they cold plane the lot, then they would have to fill it with asphalt. Asphalt set pretty much well in that day. It's a pretty fast process. So, but it's like I said, 1 to 2 day normal.
Were you targeting to have it done?
Targeting to have it probably done the first, not the first 2 weeks now, probably within the middle of September.
And how does heat affect it? It's over 100, below 190, maybe?
Not at all.
So
then would it be more advantageous for the library to close this on Thursdays and Fridays, let it set up over Saturday, Sunday, and then open on Monday?
So I'm going to speak for our patrons here.
Thank you.
If you give our patrons a choice of whether they want to park on the street and use the library or have the library completely closed, I can absolutely guarantee you every single one is going to choose to park on the street and have the library open. Oh, I see what you're saying. I thought you were saying close the library.
Yeah, I'm saying do the work midweek or somewhere in there.
More closer towards the end of the week.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And then let it set up so that you have no problems with people. You know, sometimes that asphalt, you know.
Yes, ma'am.
It does different things.
So what we could, what they could do is that sounds logical. So we have them arranged for Thursday, Friday,
mm-hmm.
Saturday, you know, or Friday, Saturday,
mm-hmm.
and Sunday it sets all day. By Monday morning, it's all up and running, painted, and you know, and pretty. So
that's a great idea, Glenn.
Yeah, and that could, and you could do that, and then you have the parking, because your most busy stays your library on Monday and Tuesday, because we're open until 9 o'clock. Yeah, and so that's very logical.
And why did you choose these particular people?
These particular people went through the 3-bid process, as you can see, went through the analysis. Rose Painting, they are a big contractor. Their pricing, of course, was a little ridiculous, but they are nationwide. But and they have different things, but it was just the cost for them was just extreme. CP&D, they're a good company. But also there's reputation that I heard about them online and things like that. It's a little skeptical. This paving company, I've seen their work before. I've seen what they've done. I've seen the quality. Their relationship that I've had with the owner has been Donald Winchell. Just met him this year, as a matter of fact, but he comes off as a very man of integrity. And he's given me information that far above the, what I need. And so it's been benefit to the to learn what I learned from him. He's told me things about storm drains and everything else. If we ever decide in the future to do something of this ripping in total, that's a total storm drain situation. So, but he's telling me that with what they're going to do now, that's not necessary. And so it's just basically repaving it over. They'll take care of whatever they need to do to get it up to standard. This, as you can see from the memo that I wrote, it has been times that we've been have not had a parking lot up for a while, you know, maintained for a while. So now we're going to do what we can to update it. And there's already 4 to 7 years we should be able to put a flurry on it, and that will protect our investment that you do now.
And what sort of guarantee have they given you if something buckles, you know, in a short period of time?
Short period of goals, it's, now you are going to get, there are roll, because of the shifting of the dirt and everything else,
mm-hmm.
there are what they call reflective cracking, because of what? Oh, because of the previous thing was done many, many years ago. We don't have conscious shifting of the dirt. You know, we live in California. So, you know, we already have that with the tree roots and everything else that can happen. So we have to make sure that the guarantee that they give is at least 10 years, 10 to 15 years while we maintain it. And the maintaining is doing the flurry every 4 to 7 years.
Is that an expensive process?
No, that will be now cut down. He was telling me about
$3,000.
Basically, that's what they developed. It's just flurry coat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's what it is. And it's just a thin coating on top of it just to just to maintain and keep the cracks from expanding. Yes.
Is that the same as the option I provide them? That the additional half inch of hot asphalt.
Basically, not it. Yes. Yeah.
It's 48.75.
Yeah.
And we have to use them in the future, or could we use another vendor?
We could find someone else that's going to be, you know, at the time. Oh, find someone else.
Does that affect the guarantee? Is there not use?
No. It does not affect the guarantee, and I know that for a fact because this company did the second flurry coat for this parking lot that I know of, and they were the second company that did it. So there was no
there's no reason for it.
Excellent. Are you recommending items, additional items 1 and 2, or is it just, because you just asked for 1 through 8?
Asking for also additional items 1 and 2, options 1 and 2, which will have extra half-inch protection on top of the parking lot. The total cost, as you can see, is
39?
Yes, yes.
And we're keeping the same number of parking spaces, right?
I think we're adding two.
So are the spaces any smaller?
No.
Sometimes you go to these mall spaces, it's super tight, and you don't help anyone.
I think I would not let that happen, because I know that I have a director that will make sure that happens.
I like the current place.
Yeah, the parking spaces will be consistent, they will be the same. We are adding one, because there's a patch of dirt that was just, yeah, and it's just there, so now we're going to fill it up. It's on the south side. Yes, ma'am.
Great, thanks, Jonathan.
Thank you.
Oh, I have a question, yeah.
Yes.
Jonathan, really great job on the write-up and the quotes. Can you just give us some examples under repairing the parking lot? You said help to prevent prevent against liability and help with ADA inspections. Those are great things, obviously. What are some of the examples of what are?
Well, when you do have any type of inspection or whatever, you know, of course, when they're doing any type of insurance, they look at the ADA, as a matter of fact. When they look at our number of our access for our handicapped area, they will go and take a look at this, especially when it's a smooth surface and it's a safe surface, free of any type of debris. Such as you see right now, we do have little potholes, and you know, I'm walking across, and you know, I'm a fairly young man. So if you go across, and then there's these chunks that you get there, you can trip over them, you know. And
we've had reports. We've already had people trip and fall in our parking lot,
yes,
because of the state of the parking lot, including myself, who sprained my ankle twice.
Right. And by preventing that, you know, that's one of the main guarantees. The ADA we're trying to be, especially since we're a library, we're trying to do everything that is ADA compliant, and you know, to bring a new error or just bring it in, you know, just, you know, so we are open to all kinds of disabilities.
Thanks, John. Okay. Then I have a motion to approve the parking lot repair costs, including option 1 and 2, the total cost of $39,515, with the director of the authority to sign the quote and issue payment upon completion of the project. I'd like to move that.
$39,515. Oh, yeah, where's the budget coming from?
So remember when we worked on the budget, and there was the $350,000 for repairs to the facilities? That's where it's coming from.
Is that a line item in the budget?
Yes, it is. Oh. Under facilities.
Do we have a motion?
So the motion needs to, unless you want to, someone wants to come and sign the check and the contract, it needs to include approving the director to do.
That's what I read. I got to obey them. Do I have to read it again?
No, I can't hear you guys. It's something about the way you're facing and the way I'm sitting. I can't hear what you're saying.
It's hard for us out here, too, so, you know.
Yeah.
You ever want to go to a sound system? Feel free.
I'll say it again then, that the Board of Trustees approved the parking lot repair costs, including optional items 1 and 2, for the total cost of $39,515, and give the director the authority to sign the quote and issue payment upon completion of the project. Could I have a motion to that, please?
So moved.
Second.
Ayes?
Aye.
All in favor? All none. Very good, it passes. So we did that. We're on to item 8. New business, annual review of outsourcing of human resources. We have
I provided you a report. It's on page 61. Are there any questions or comments?
Adriana's going to present.
She's at item number 10. We're on item 9.
10, I was reading. Right, 9. What's on item 9? Where are you guys going?
Yeah, but Mindy wrote a written report for 9. Audrey, any
61.
I think we removed both item B and F, but we removed F and just approved it, but we didn't do the same for D. So do we need to?
I think I'll just rephrase it as.
Oh, it doesn't need it.
Not separately, we're considering the items that were removed for a motion.
But if it had stayed in the consent calendar, we would have approved it, but since we pulled it out, we need to approve it.
Yes.
Yes, yeah, yeah. So I'll make a motion to approve the departmental monthly reports, particularly with an amendment under the IT report revising the phrasing of the monthly report.
I think it's a.
So we, let's take a vote. To approve. Department monthly report.
For John.
My motion.
For John.
Correct.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Saying no? Approve.
So we must.
Do you have any questions on item nine? Any other questions on item nine on page 61?
I just wanted to comment that I think that outsourcing to HR Network has been working out very well for us. I think it was a very smart move for the library to make, and I'm pleased with the work that they provided for us.
Human resource update, written report by HR Network. Question on this here.
Hi, Adrienne Adams. Okay, so just to show you the report, we did have, we had a couple things going on. We actually had a pregnant employee went out earlier than expected. So out on her pregnancy disability leave. And a couple of issues that we dealt with over the month. We are working on revising, Lorraine from our team is working with Ryan to revise the FMPs and update them to the Stratix process. So Stratix is off running, everything's going very smoothly. Nicole was a great deal of why that transition happened so smoothly as well. But now they're updating the SOPs to make sure that everybody's on board with the process of onboarding, when an employee transaction occurs, when a leave of absence happens, that kind of thing. I'm also working with Minnie and Ryan on the job description, and then we're also going to be working on, we're continuing to work on the compensation program. So where we are right now is that the librarians have been conducting market data research, and Minnie's going to be getting me that shortly. As we've discussed, we're working on going to a merit-based pay system. And I know there's been a lot of questions around the issue of step versus merit increase. I'm not as familiar with that because it's a PAL system and I'm working on a new system. So actually I've asked Nicole just to explain to us the difference today and be able to answer any questions you had of step versus merit.
Okay, so I have a copy here of our old employee handbook, which is where the step and merit system is kind of outlined. The steps are 1 through 5.5, and I'm not sure when we actually got our step calendar, when it was first created, but that's what we've been using for many, many years, and we've just been updating it over the years. new employees and employees who are promoted serve a 6-month probationary period, and they're often started at step one unless their education or work experience allows them to be hired on at a higher step. Once they've completed their 6-month probationary period, they are eligible for a step increase. This isn't necessarily considered a merit-based increase. The steps are set, they're defined, they're not arbitrary. You're only allowed to bump them up to the next step within their salary range when they have done satisfactory work over that 6-month period. After that, employees are eligible for annual evaluations, and again, if their work is satisfactory, they are once again bumped up to the next step. Once they reach step 5.5, they are no longer eligible for step increases. There is no merit system. Unless they get promoted to a different position, there's really no way for them to achieve a higher rate of salary, short of the board-approved increases that happen at the beginning of the fiscal year. So those are always considered cost-of-living increases, or they're increases based on competition in the area, or things like that. Alpena Library, a few years ago, was underpaid compared to other libraries in the area, and that's why Mindy has asked librarians to do a compensation survey of other libraries in the area to figure out kind of where we stand and to see if our steps are similar to other districts. And actually, Cindy has worked with many districts that also use the step system. So even though it's not terribly common in most businesses, for special districts, it is effective to use. Any questions?
Yeah, with the step and the merit and the COLA, cost of living, do they compound on top of each other, or one can only get a step, or one, does everyone get the COLA? How does that work?
Every single employee gets the board approved increase. So at the beginning of the fiscal year, if you guys approve a cost of living increase, it applies to every single employee, no matter their status, full-time, part-time. If their anniversary happens to fall within that same year, and they have not maxed out their salary range, and they have a good performance rating, they are eligible for a step increase.
So
the step increases are applied to the payroll schedule on July 1st, though.
If it's a board approved increase, yes.
So someone could actually get both?
Yes.
And get a step and a...
And a cost of living increase. Yes.
Got it.
So there's after 10 years, there's no incentive and such a thing, a 10-year, 20-year.
Our people who are at step 5.5 only get increases if the board elects to give everyone an increase at the beginning of the fiscal year, which is one of the reasons we want to move away from the step system, because the people who have been here for many, many years don't have the incentive.
So, as I understand it too, the steps kind of act like a band, a range.
Yes.
So, what I want to do is, in the compensation system that I'm going to put together, which is more typical, is that what we're doing right now is we are identifying market value. That's what the librarians are doing for us, market data, so that we can take all the job slots and based on market value, and assign grades to them so that all jobs will fit within a grade grid, if you will, and there'll be an entry rate and a maximum rate and a midpoint rate. And so people will fall in that based on their years of experience, performance over time, et cetera. By the way, this is going to become really, really important because what I need to be signed off on, and it's probably going to happen by the end of the year, is that we're no longer going to be able to ask candidates what their prior salary was. So this is something I want to have ready, because by the time this law passes, what's going to happen is we're going to have to do a good offer to people based on the market value of the job, not knowing what they made. And so that's going to change kind of the way we recruit and how we hire people. But it did appear to me, in looking initially at market values, that the library was a little undervalued in some of the jobs and in some of the pay rates. So that's our whole goal, is to kind of move from the system she just described into kind of a normal market-based system, mid-max, right, based on the value of the job.
Question.
And then what will happen is you'll get an annual merit increase, one increase, based on two factors, where you fall in the range and your performance rating.
I have a question.
Yes.
You said you two factors, but that's the discretion of the director then that can decide if an employee gets
supervisor.
Or should be a supervisor.
But there'll be guidelines to it, right? So if I get so we're creating a merit matrix system as well, three rating system, exceed, fully competent, needs some draining improvement, et cetera. So if you fall into fully competent, which we want the majority of people to fall in, right, because that's what we hire them for, and they're in, let's say, the first quartile, they would be eligible for maybe 4% or 5%. But the higher you go up the range, the less percent you're eligible for. If you get an exceeds rating, though, that would bump you up a little bit. You'd be eligible for more. So eventually, I'll have something for the board to look at. I'm hoping maybe October-ish timeframe, based on what we're putting together.
I have a question for you. You mentioned that our existing system, somebody comes in at the bottom step, unless they have additional qualifications or education or something that
yes.
brings them up. Is there a justification, like a hiring above minimum process that determines who comes in at a higher level other than the minimum?
It depends on like the education or the work requirements that are the minimum for the job listing. So if for a job listing it required, you know, 3 years of work experience and a bachelor's, and we brought in somebody who had 5 years experience and a master's, they would be hired at a higher step than the step one qualification.
Yeah, exactly. It could be higher, right?
It could be.
Could be.
Not necessarily. Yes. Right. It's based on the supervisor of that department.
Right. There's no criteria set in stone to apply the steps.
I don't believe that. This time.
No, it's up to the discretion of the people on the interview panel and the director. We discuss it and we make a determination based on what we see. But most positions we start at step one. And the other thing I want to mention is the first year when we went to the budget committee with Meredith and Gwen, and we requested the 4% raise across the board. Part of the reasoning behind that was because the majority of the staff that was in the CalPERS retirement plan was paying 4% of the 7% of their portion into the retirement. So the library was paying, or they were paying 3%, and the library was paying the other 4% of their portion into the retirement, in addition to the library's portion that went into CalPERS. So what we discussed was doing this over 2 years. So we gave a 4% raise. Most of the employees that were full-time only received a 2% raise because their contribution to CalPERS was raised by 2% at that time. And then we did that again the next year, exactly the same way. So now all employees are paying the full amount allowed by CalPERS into the CalPERS, and the library is no longer supplementing the employee's portion of their retirement. The reason that was done way back when was because the board agreed that the librarians were underpaid, and that was a way that they felt that they could add more value to the job. And so that's why that was done at the time.
And two more questions, point of clarification. So, Audrey, you said the step schedule is banned, but there's only one number, so it's actually not a band. Is that correct?
It is. There's a step one through step five and a half. So each step is in its own band, but each job classification has one through five and a half, the minimum at one and the maximum at five and a half.
Okay, maybe I'm misunderstanding. Band would normally mean there's a range within some amount. So step one could be $10 to $15. That's not correct.
No, so our lowest step would be minimum wage $10.50.
How are you using the term band?
The one through five and a half would be the range for that particular job classification. But there's one pay rate per step.
I think each step is a percentage, right?
It is.
Yeah.
Is it a fixed percentage or a change in the
It's fixed. So depending on what the board approves, each pay rate gets increased, whatever the board approves. So recently, it was, every step was increased 4%.
And then people have discussed merit, or use the term merit. There is not and has never been a merit-based increase system at all. So you would either get board-approved cost of living and or step increase, which is actually the same thing, compounded, right?
So would you get both? So if someone starts at $1,000 a month and they reach the next step, let's say the next step is 10% increase, they're $1,100, and then they get the cost of living, let's say 4% on top of that. So in effect, they got a 14% raise. Is that right?
Yes, but I don't think anyone's gotten that kind of increase. I think the highest is
9.
I'm moving.
Yeah. So everyone is subject to the step. And then if the board approves a cost of living increase, they also get that.
Someone get 9%. How does that? Can you give us an example?
A 5% step and a 4% cost of living.
So everybody that got step should have gotten 9%.
Not everybody got a step increase.
Not everybody.
But everybody did get a 4%.
Well, one person got a step increase.
Not everyone did, no.
But more than one person.
Yeah.
But only one person got 9%.
No.
About
half. Nine? Wasn't it about half? I said you guys had some data, and I showed you who got increases. It was at least a third.
Brian and I worked on that spreadsheet, so we believe it's 50%. At this time, 50% are still within the STEP system and got both the STEP and the cost of living.
Any other questions? I want to move along.
Yeah, so I just wanted to explain that part. That's what it is. We're working on regular merit within a regular compensation adjustment program. But it really, my goal is to get it done by the end of the year, because like I said, there's a law that we feel fairly confident that is going to pass by the end of the year. It says you can no longer ask prior salary, so you make an offer. That's really going to change the way recruiting is done.
Do you have to
send it off? I don't, off the top of my head, but.
And one final thing I'd like to add, that over the years, starting with the 13-14, and I provided you guys all with this package previously, but this increase with the COLA and the steps and everything has been taken into the budget process every single year. And we still are maintaining high 60s to low 70s percentage of the budget is for wages, salaries, and benefits. So we are well within the norm. Most California libraries' wages are a much higher percentage of the budget. And so we're not like working outside of the range of.
I don't think we're asking questions because we think that aspect is outside of the norm or the budget is available. But we're asking questions because of an issue related to transparency.
Right, yeah.
And that's part of why I asked Nicole to explain it, because I'm not sure I understand it completely. So since she and the accountants are the ones really overseeing who, you know, the financial side of it. I thought you could explain it a little better.
Okay,
thank you.
There was a public comment form related to it. I know we're out of
the
public comment
period, though. Well, there can be specific. There's general public comment and then specific item, but it's up to you to ask.
Point of clarification? I think you have to take it by law if there's a public comment on a specific item.
Is that true?
Well, I was looking at the bylaws, and it does say that the president, something about the president.
It's part of the Brown Act that you have public comments on non-specific,
general,
but each agenda
right.
item you can have specific.
Yeah. Hey, Mark, you have 3 minutes.
Okay. So, and many might be mad at this, but let me just tell you a couple things about your salaries. First of all, public agencies all across, and our modern knows this, and I think that's why you asked the question about longevity pay, because in the teacher system, they have that. But they don't have it as much in the public system of other stuff. But you've got a couple different unique things here. So one is, there's only about 15% of public agencies that pay into Social Security. You're one of them. And so when you look at compensation, if you just look at salary range across the board, and you have a senior librarian making $65,000 here and $65,000 or $68,000 somewhere else, what you forget about is when they retire, they get Social Security, if you're in this agency, and you don't get a reduction in Social Security if you've been with a public agency for 30 years. So somebody who retires from a public agency that has paid Social Security, they're going to get a much higher retirement benefit than somebody else that might have the higher salary if they're at the same 2% at 55. It's important that you know that. I think this is not an action item. I think it says information on here, so you're not taking action today, which is good, and I think your questions were pretty right on. There's a couple things, though, that I would love to share with you. I'm not going to have time to do it, but a couple things is, I think the answer that you got on understanding the step increases, you didn't get a correct answer exact. And so I'll just tell you real quick, if you start at step one, you get to step 5.5, and your step differences are 5.5%, just add it up, it's 22.5 approximately. The difference that you get, or 27.5, that you get from when you start at $2,000 a month, and then you can get up to the top after 5.5 years. But if you also get a promotion within your system, you also then get another step increase because you're going into a different classification. I just think all those things are important, especially when you decide you want to get away from steps and go to merit. And if you go to merit, which is not a bad thing, but there are public agencies that haven't had as good of reception with it from their employee groups, and I think this is the kind of thing that hopefully, you would ask, Mindy, to have somebody who represents your employees here actually give their opinion on what they might think might be proposed, because you want happy employees. Longevity pay is something that does occur in some public agencies, but not a lot. When you get to the top of your step, you know it, and that's why you're there. I mean, you're in a public agency, and I know you know that. When you get to step five, now I'll tell you, the city of Los Angeles just went to a 12-step system. So you can go to a 12-step system and just make them 3% in between. There's a lot of ways to do it, so I ask that you don't rush into this and that you learn more about it. It's important.
Thank you for your input, Mark. It is appreciated.
Sorry, Mindy.
Yes. So, Mark, I'd like to comment on your comment. Thank you very much. And I think that's why you've got these questions about the compensation pool. I've been on the board, I think, 3 fiscal years, and we've never approved a fiscal year budget on salaries other than a 4% increase. So it's never been communicated to the board that there was a step system. So obviously, as people move through the step systems, it should have been analyzed, and it should have been put into the budget.
Oh, I almost would guarantee you that they're analyzed and put in because, you know, whether it was Susan when she was here, whether it was Nicole, even Mindy, as she gives you your budget, they have done a calculation, because I will tell you, and you don't have a lot of employees that are as feisty as they used to be, some of the employees that worked here, but they would have been at your board meeting screaming that if the amount of money that the board was being presented to take care of salaries for the next fiscal year did not include steps and step increases, you definitely would have heard about it, John. So I, you know, maybe it wasn't communicated in such a way that you got educated enough on it to understand, but there is no question that the budget cannot be built by law without taking into account the salary system that is in place. And if it wasn't quite communicated effectively to the 5 board members, then you know, maybe it was just a misunderstanding of exactly what that meant from the salary. But the number of
share your trust and faith in the process, but I am telling you it has not been communicated to us.
And I would like to point out that in your board package, at least 5 times since I have been here, the salary schedule with the full steps has been in your board package at least 5 times in the past 3 years with discussions about the step system. It is part of the budget process. It was Ryan and I discussed it in our budget meetings when we talked about moving away from a step system and going to a merit system. why we wanted to do it, because we didn't like the way that this rewarded people, whether they had merit or not. Definitely, we discussed it in our budget discussions with Meredith and Gwen when I put together that budget committee. But I provided you with this document, John. I emailed it to the full board. I don't remember what day, probably August 8th. All the board packages are here, all the copies of all the step salary schedules with the director on them are in this package. Do you have any questions about that?
I would like you to resend that to everybody and pass me as well.
I have it here physically. I will give it to each one of you.
This is not an agenda item to discuss today, but we would appreciate the documentation.
Yeah, I mean, I think what's been confusing, I mean, I know there's been reference to the step system, but I think what hasn't been clear has been how the step system functions with all of these other, you know, COLA increases that folks have been getting. I think that's where there's been some lack of, you know.
In the past, and as the director, once the budget was approved, she would then in July provide the updated salary schedule and at the top of the page.
About them.
Okay.
In depth.
Okay, but I'm just still saying,
it would be really good for us to know that this is priority number one, two, and three in some sort of order, so that we know that these have been taken care of, whatever.
So I'll provide a facility in the staff reports. I'll add a facilities report with a breakdown of a chart of every project that we're working on.
Well, which one's being done first or second, whatever. It, you know, something so that, because when I looked at this, I'm trying to figure out, is the parking lot more important than the leaks on, you know? I mean, I know that California, we don't have a lot of leaks, but that's okay. I understand.
Right. So we're working on all of those projects right now.
Okay. We're working on them simultaneously.
Yes.
That's what I need to know. Okay.
So a point of clarification. I thought that the last meeting we had tabled the determining contract, and now I see it saying that we're under contract.
On the what?
Not correct. The tree maintenance?
Mm-hmm.
Tree trimming?
You tabled it?
We did. I believe we did. I believe Ira did, specifically.
Yeah, I believe that was the case. Okay, we'll look at the minutes.
Was that last month?
I believe so.
And why did we table the tree, maintenance of the trees?
It was probably related to the cost and maybe the quotes that were received. I don't know. I don't remember. All I did, all I noticed was I remember that we had said we were going to wait on the trees. Wait on making a decision. Given the uproar over this, I think we should hold off.
Right.
So.
Right, we're not chopping any trees. We're like taking down like dead palm things that are.
Thank you for the explanation. I would just suggest, in the interest of positive PR, that we hold off on this until we find out if we actually approved it, and then address it.
Okay, we'll re-listen to the recording and we'll report back.
So are we done with A then?
If you have no questions about the final report on the renovations, then I'll move on to the next item. No questions? Okay, so the next item is the Taste of Dena update, which is on page 86 and 87. Since the time we created that report, we've now sold 48 out of 225 tickets. We have $4,000 in sponsors, and we have $4,875 total in revenue to date. We have all of our beer and alcohol vendors, and we just added all to eat. To the restaurant vendors, and we're still working on that list. And the committee met on last week, and they wanted to offer the board a table at the Taste of Dena. Since this is a fundraising event, they feel like they want to honor the board and have the board available for the public and be visible to the public who would be attending the event. And so I do want to note that I need to know as soon as possible if it will be one person, and that so we're providing one ticket at the table, and also because the value of the ticket is $50, you'll have to report this on your form 700 when you do that. I believe you do that annually as a gift from the Albertina Library Foundation.
Let me just ask this question then, Mindy, because I've already given a contribution to that. I really don't think that I need to receive a ticket for that event. I've already given a contribution for Albertina, a taste of Albertina.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's very kind of the committee to do that.
Are you saying that you could vote, you would be there?
I will be there, but I don't think I need to deduct the $50, because I've spent more than $50 for it.
So you wouldn't have to declare it on your.
So I don't need to report it on my number 737.
Right.
That number.
I'm just.
You're going, but you don't want the free, not free.
I don't want the not.
Okay, so if you can get back to me by the end of the week, that would be great. On that, item C is the reason why the bylaws are in the package. It is my request that the bylaws have not been updated, I believe, what is it?
2008.
After review of the bylaws, there's about 20 areas that really need to be corrected and addressed. And so I'm asking that there be a subcommittee and/or a special meeting created to address this long overdue task.
Can we get a copy of the 2008 minutes? It appears from the bottom of the document, it says 10/30/06.
I believe those are up on the website, and we can email those to you as well.
Yeah, because this one says 10/30/06, and it supersedes the 08, which means someone crowded it.
Yeah, I think that that's a clerical error from whoever did these minutes. I believe that this is the 08, the revised 08 minutes, but they left that little footnote there.
They never dated, they don't have a signed dated copy anywhere.
In the file.
Maybe we're.
Then they don't.
The older one.
They.
Proposed one.
We don't.
Maybe we don't have that one.
Right. Which is why we create.
So can I suggest that you guys then put those 08 changes into your suggested revisions for the current bylaws, and then we review all of them all at the same time? Because if the 08s aren't signed, then they don't, they're not enforced.
Even the 2006 ones aren't signed, we don't have them signed.
You have, you, what you have in your hand, we believe to be the 2008. And the minutes do not give an in-depth description of what was revised. And and are you, so are, what I thought I heard, so I just want to clarify, you would like us to make the suggestions for the changes to the bylaws and then provide those to you at the next board meeting, or?
Well, I would suggest then we go back to the last signed copy, find that, and then whatever documents we have that are unsigned, that have changes, you know, and it's laborious work, but you have to go, you know, word by word through all of the documents. But we need to, if the 04s are signed, we need to then approve the 06s, the 08s, and any current 17s. And since you said there are 18 or 20 areas that you noticed that need to be updated, I think it would help us if you made all those recommendations, including the not necessarily signed and approved ones all at once, and that would give us something to work from to revise those bylaws.
Okay, so you don't want to create a subject committee right now, and you'll discuss it when we provide you with our recommendations?
Recommendations or just changes?
Well, we can't make changes.
Yeah, we only.
The suggestion would be that. Or recommendations, I guess.
Yeah, we can make recommendations, for sure, yeah.
Do you want to get those first, and then we'll just create a subcommittee?
Yes or no, I don't think a subcommittee is necessary, I think the whole board should work.
I agree with John, at this stage, I don't think a subcommittee, we have to first see what is in existence, what sign, what are we operating from, and then what are the proposed changes? And I also think somebody's got to go through all the existing statutes that are here to make sure that they're correct, or that we're addressing the right ones. Then I think we can decide, once we have that information, to develop a subcommittee to review all the information.
So So I'm going to actually hire an attorney to do that. Because we don't have that legal level of skill. And there are attorneys that have been recommended to me that do bylaws for nonprofits and districts. And so I'm going to bring an attorney in to look at that part of it, and then we'll make the recommendations on the things that we know in here are no longer accurate or relevant to the district, just so you know.
So an attorney looking up the government codes and making sure they're correct, or an attorney going through the old bylaws and figuring out?
We'll go through boxes and boxes and boxes of stuff and look for what we can find. I will have an attorney review all the suggestions we're making and anything that we refers to code and everything before I present it to you. I don't want to present it to you and then take it to the attorney and have the attorney say,
yes.
Oh, well, this is no longer the way we do this.
Yeah. No, I think that's a good idea.
Then the attorney's going to have to review the changes that we've made.
Yes, the attorney will then. If you make changes after that, then the attorney will review. That's the way it goes. Okay, and then item 11D, which is pages 88 through 91, that is the strategic plan that was created in 2014-15, and I would like to request again there be either a special meeting and or a subcommittee to start to talk about the process, what the value would be, how we might go about it, and the need for an updated strategic plan. And I also provided you with another document earlier. It was on your desk there when you came in. It has a little bit more discussion about my request on the strategic plan in that document as well.
And so what page is it on?
That's on page 88 through 91. I also talk about it in my report. If you look at my report at the beginning, on page 83. Yeah, 83. At the beginning, the very first top part talks about the strategic plan. It talks about the one change that the board made to it. When I first got here, we asked to change item 4 to lifelong learning, and why I'm requesting that we start to at least talk about when and how we want to move forward with the strategic plan. I believe I also sent you an email as well with information from the consultant about the process of strategic planning and how that would and could progress, one way that it could and would progress.
Well, I don't think a special meeting is going to be sufficient because it seems like it's a longer discussion. So I don't think we want to do a subcommittee at this point.
Yeah. own strategic plan. Most libraries nowadays do strategic plans more in the 3-year range. And I don't think that that strategic plan is reflective of our community and the goals that we've heard through the community, that what the community has been talking about in community conversations and the different aspirations and needs, so what libraries are doing nowadays, how we're doing them, our own particular needs for facilities, ADA, asbestos, bathrooms. There's a lot of things that are really important to this district right now that are not really included in that strategic plan.
The strategic plan was approved in 2013 for the strategic plan starting in the year
2014. Yeah.
I don't know how long that
the whole big thing. A lot of what you mentioned seems to be operational more than from the
No, it was very strategic. And in addition to that, when the strategic plan was created, I was provided when I came here with a survey that was used to help create this strategic plan. And 99% of the people that completed the strategic plan, the survey, were users of the library. We have a lot more information now about the people of Altadena, especially people that are not necessarily library users. And I think, you know, as we reform and expand our support groups, they have a lot of questions about the direction of the library and what's going to be supported by the board and in the strategic plan. And I feel like it's time to at least start the conversation.
Well, I think it's a little bit more than a subcommittee, so I don't want to vote on anything now. If someone has a different opinion.
Well, Mindy, can you maybe talk a little bit more about, so you would like to have a subcommittee to start the discussion about a strategic plan?
Yes.
I'm wondering if it would be helpful if we had, or maybe this is part of what you want in the committee, but I'm thinking that maybe it would be helpful to have a sense from you about what you think it looks, what the trajectory you think might look like towards getting to a strategic plan. Like, for example, you know, are we going to want to have a dedicated group of people outside of the board and outside of the staff
can resend the email that I sent an email with that information, so I'll resend that and I'll put it in next month's board package as well.
Can you answer a question to that? If you could give us an idea of how we ask, do you have 25 people prepared to go, or
No. That's what I want the committee to talk about. I want the committee to decide, how do we want to approach this strategic planning? Do we want to bring in a consultant? The consultant may have multiple different ideas of how best to, you know, develop the plan and speak to the community. We have input from one consultant. There are multiple different ways to do strategic planning, and I am not making a suggestion of exactly how we do it this time beyond starting to have a subcommittee that, yes, would have more than just board members on it. There should be a member of the Friends, there should be a member of the Foundation, there should possibly be other people on the subcommittee as well, probably some staff members. And then if there is a move to move on to strategic planning, then a much larger committee would be involved. Yeah.
I'm not sure if we're in the subcommittee at this point. I want to digest it, thanks, but I need input from the rest of the board. What do they think?
Anyone want to talk to the committee at this point? We can bring this back up again next time.
This is the first time we're seeing this, so we need to digest it. How do we look at them?
I guess for me, I'm just, you it would be helpful for us to maybe just even discuss when we say we want to digest it and talk about it next month, to maybe just discuss what it is we want to be thinking about. Like, are, in the next month, we want to think about what might be the best way to go about it, or in this next month, we want to think about what is it that we want to be thinking about when we come back to discuss it. That would be helpful for me.
I have to think about
I'll echo Armando and Adelila's suggestions, which I think are in line with what I was thinking. First of all, I think the strategic plan is fine, and I don't think there's an urgency to immediately start work on revising it, so I think we're okay waiting a few more months. I also do not recall any information about logistics around forming the subcommittee. So I would recommend, to Adelila's point, that Mindy come back next month with a proposal on how big is the subcommittee, how many board members, how many community members, you know, some kind of time frame for how they're gonna work and goals that you want them to meet over the course of time. And I think that would help us then reframe our mindset around strategic planning. I think it's a good idea. We do need a new strategic plan to replace this one, and it's better to plan ahead than be caught with no time. I think we need more information around the subcommittee specifically.
I think probably the interviews might want to include some of the things that you've talked about, addressing ADA, some of the issues that we really do need to do as far as renovation might go. This one talks not really about funding for any other renovations, and we've already used the HUD fund for renovation number one. Okay, so maybe you should sort of, you generally have a whole bunch of listing of different kinds of things that you want to see happen, so maybe that would be a part of this whole strategy, because we really do need to move it out of just the board and the friends. The community needs to be involved in it in a setting that is. And I would suggest that if we had to have someone to be a lead person or to direct us or to deal with the just as we had Stu, I would suggest we have somebody from the California Library Association to actually help us through that process.
There's many consultants who are more than happy that help lead the strategic planning process once we've decided to do one.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I can provide more information.
But I am glad that this is in here, and I do think that we need to revisit our strategic plan, and that even just in terms of the time frame, it's healthy for us to do so every so often. And I can see some things that I feel like we've already have been working on, and things that we've accomplished that are in our strategic plan, and that it's time to, in order for us to be able to continue moving forward, that we need to be able to revisit it.
And then finally, if you look on pages 96 through page 101, I provided the document that the consultant created for the board that he was going to discuss with you when if there was a meeting. And if you look on page 98 in the middle, he also provides you a little bit of a description on planning the direction of the library and the role of the board. And then again, like I said, I sent an email, which I should have included in this board package, but I will definitely include it in next month's board package, along with the staff report, with my recommendation to create a subcommittee with a member from the Friends and the Foundation and from staff.
Thanks. We're going to take a 5 minute break. Oh, sorry, John, I had one to
Just the last thing on the director's report. Just a note on page 83, under community competition, under your report, the final item, I'm talking about Artisanal LA.
Mm-hmm.
We were approached by Artisanal LA, which is owned by a local Altadena, to volunteer and kind of work together with them in November, community event with food trucks, block party, so on and so forth. Just so you know, it was announced on social media that that event is already confirmed and approved.
Yeah.
How come the board didn't know about any of this?
The board doesn't approve programming.
If it involves food trucks and block parties and possible permits and things like that, the board normally would at least hear about it as an informational item. I have no problem with the event. I'm just pointing out that we've had some issues of communication about these types of things. And when people reached out to me after that was announced on social media, I had to say I have no idea. I'm not knowledgeable about that at all. It puts the board in a bad position. And we can't, we have trouble supporting these events if we can't discuss them.
Yeah, that's, I try my best to notify you guys in the board package, but programming is definitely under the purview of the staff and the director. And I am a little confused about the direction of your question.
I think the board would appreciate heads up on things like this, especially when they're gays and they're out there in the community, whether we have a role in them or not. It's probably better to have us involved and knowledgeable about them so we can respond to the community and support these events. But when we're not notified about them, even the possibility, it makes us it puts us in an awkward position with our constituents.
So you want to be notified of programs besides in the board package, besides the newsletter, besides the e-blast?
I think that would be who. Sorry, Kevin, what were you saying?
This is the first board meeting since the event has been confirmed. So I don't know if there was another opportunity.
Well, the director is able to communicate with us outside of board meetings.
Right. I do send a lot of emails, but I don't get a lot of response. So.
All right, we're going to take
a question. We have a permit for the food and spending for that day.
They take care of all of that.
Who is that?
Are they Artisanal LA? I have an agreement with them that it's all covered.
Okay, if you could send that.
And there's no charge on their part to the library.
If you could send a copy of the food spending permit to the board, that'd be great. Thank you.
Well, that I don't have. That's all.
We're going to take a 5-minute break, so we're still in open session. So we'll be back at 6:38. We'll be back at 6:43.
Armando, you asked me about Bill Davy.
Sharon and I were found in the memory.
important.
Yes, thank you.
We missed it too. Because I call the rain every time.
Quinn, you handing out money there? Is that should we do it online?
ATA membership. She's a private citizen.
That's pretty good.
So we're ready. Okay, 6:44, we're back in the open session, and we're up to item 12, correspondence. We got an award letter. Just say 1 minute.
Nothing to say.
Nothing to say. Great, we got an award letter from CLLS. Okay, the support group, the Library Foundation.
Good afternoon. For you, those of you that don't know me, I was previously the finance HR director here at the library.
And your name is?
Susan Olmstead Bowen. Thank you. And I retired from the library district in 2011. So since then, I was a founding member with Sharon for the Altadena Library Foundation, and I've always been the accountant. And when there was a sizable request, I was asked to come back and help the treasurer. Now we need board members. So I'm asking everybody to put out their feelers and find board members. Mark is going to be one of our board members. And we need to do this by October 31st because we have to have independent board members for the statement of information for the state of California, every annual, biannual registration. I also wanted to report that We have $554,000 in the foundation, and of that, $203,000 is restricted for branch, for projects in the branch only. So hopefully we'll get a bunch of members that will fundraise and we'll be able to fund some of your projects.
It's a good question right now. So really, it's pretty safe to say that this event, which is really not meant to make lots of money, will make money. So I think that's a good thing. And the Friends actually approved $1,000 to be a sponsor also. So we had our board, first board meeting. We have our next one September 11th. Are you still our, you're our liaison, right, for the, so September 11th here. We approved $24,000 for this fiscal year coming up. You know, last year it was only 20. Specifically though, we actually laid it out, and so I know Mindy has the layout, but the biggest bulk goes to literacy, and you know, just with the last item you had talked about where you get the grant from the library, state library, there has to be a matching component. So we're always proud to be part of that matching component for $10,000 that helps you get about 70% more of that amount of money towards literacy here in the district. And with that, you know, we have a friend that we met who's being more of a friend of the library. So I'm going to give over my last minute to Allison Crawford.
Well, thank you so much. I'm Allison Crawford from the Alpine Elementary PTA. I'm the face of PTA, but we do have a full board. We're delighted that we could be part of the community feature for the August newsletter to promote the Alpine Elementary PTA and our programs. We're delighted that we will be able to have our meeting here on Tuesday, October 10th, and I hope to get that on the community calendar really soon. Our plan is to get all of our children a fine free library card. So PTA is undertaking this role to make sure all of our children have these library cards. So the form that you guys use, we will reduplicate it, and we will put it in their PTA folder so they can submit them back to the PTA officers. We'll come up here during the week to make sure that the cards are issued, and then we will distribute them October 10th for the meeting. So we do hope that you'll be present if you'd like to be put on the board agenda for that particular meeting. You have my email address. I'm more than happy to give you some time to speak. We have a scholastic book fair that's not coming up until 2018, but it's the week of April 23rd through April 27th. And on Tuesday, April 24th, is Alcadena Elementary Open House. As the PTA president, I'm asking if there's someone from the board who could be present, maybe with a table from the library to just showcase the partnership that we're trying to build. Because by that time, we'll probably have new officers, and here's my fifth grader, and we'll be moving on. So I'm hoping to keep the visibility going, to keep supporting the school. You know, we do have a new principal there, and we want to continue to support. I also would like to encourage you as a private citizen to join the PTA. Your funds go to wonderful programs that we have. We support AstroCamp at the school. We help students to be able to get their uniforms. We are going to have a fundraiser family fun night at Baskin Robbins because they are one of the national sponsors of PTA. So we are doing our best to participate in PTA programs and fundraising arms. We also have the PTA Reflections program that I'll be talking more to Mindy about because we'd love to use this place as our contest site. So that'll be coming up. That's a program that the national PTA has for all units to adopt, and we've decided to adopt it here at the local level. So thank you for your time. I hope we can continue building our partnership with Alpine Elementary PTA. Thank you.
Thank you,
Allison.
Thank you,
Marcus.
Marcus, I was at the meeting that you had, that first meeting, and the way you itemized everything out of how the money is going instead of all through, very good. Thank you. All right, so the Board of Trustees, anyone have any comments before we go into the closed session?
Well, I'm just going to say that the Eclipse event was absolutely fabulous. I said that there must have been 300 or 400 people here to make it up of that meeting, but I'm telling you, it was wonderful. And I was so impressed with kids and what they had to do and what they said and what they did. There was one that was taking pictures of the eclipse with his camera and his glasses that he had. And I thought, oh my God, how ingenious that was. And of course, you were so good about having showing us a space up and up there where you could really see without even having glasses or anything.
Well, we were definitely still using the glasses, but there was a spot where the sunlight was coming through the window upstairs, and there were people coming in, hanging their heads a little bit. They had missed it outside, and we were there to see. You can still see it right through here. We had a pair of glasses. We caught a lot of people. It was
wonderful. And I had an opportunity to just speak, and I don't speak for the board, but I just wanted to thank a young man from
think his name was Jeff from JPL, who did a really fabulous job, and all the volunteers that were around. It was just fabulous. Thank you.
Big shout out to Uni, who did a lot of work on that program, and Kate, who's on pregnancy leave, did a lot of the build-up work for the program before she went on leave. But
I just want to make a comment on that. I had my husband call the library that day because I suspected that something was going on here, and whoever he spoke with on the phone told him there was nothing happening for the eclipse that day. So I just want to point out that somewhere there was some miss. I said, no, I'm pretty sure there's something happening at the library that day.
Yeah,
and apparently it was grand.
But we missed it.
Maybe.
Any other trustee comments? Okay, well, we're going to go into a closed session. Can you stay one moment?